Hello and welcome to this session of CynEdge.io. CynEdge.io is a brand new open source project for lightweight IoT devices that is vendor agnostic, and it comes with a device management agent providing over-the-air updates and more. My name is Stefan Vaillant, and I'm the chief architect of Software AG. In this session, we are going to provide you with some background on the CynEdge.io project. With Industry 4.0, or industrial IoT, more and more industrial equipment is becoming connected. Connectivity here means that you connect machinery like pumps, sensors, or PLCs to typically cloud-based IoT platforms. So on the cloud side, there's a well-established, ready-to-use ecosystem of IoT platforms that makes it easy and cost-efficient to manage thousands of IoT devices. Example IoT platforms are, of course, Software AG, Cumulocity IoT, or Azure IoT, or others. However, on the device side, as we learned from many of our IoT projects since 2010, we have seen that equipment manufacturers are facing challenges when it comes to creating this connectivity. Manufacturers had two options. So either they use a software stack on the device side that is dependent on the IoT platform vendor, which resulted then in a lock-in to the specific vendor. And even more important, it created also a lock-in for the customers of these manufacturers. So the factories, the shop floor, the users of this equipment were also bound to the same IoT platform. So consequently, quite some manufacturers selected a second option, which is they created their own software stack on the device. That's of course possible, it's just quite some effort. And in many cases, we have seen that it missed a lot of features, for example, in the device management area. So now there's a third option with CynEdge.io. It provides you with an open source IoT platform agnostic framework that provides many device management features. So CynEdge has been initiated by IFM and Software AG, and I'm very delighted to welcome my joint partner with whom together we created CynEdge, Joachim Teusner, who is CTO of IFM Solutions. Hi, Joachim. Do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, Stefan. Thank you. I'm Joachim Teusner, CTO of IFM Solutions at the IFM Group of Companies. The IFM Group of Companies is a global industry leader for innovative sensors, controllers, and systems for industrial automation and digitization. We are present in 230 locations around in 46 countries worldwide. And in 2020, we reached our first billion euros of turnover with a customer base of 183,000 customers. So you see, we are very widespread on a wide range of customers, on a variety of branches, of customer sizes. So I think we also will get to this back again and again during this conversation. And the IFM Solutions is the digitization division of IFM. So at this point, it comes natural to talk about software, to talk about architecture, about technology, of course, cloud also. And so I'm very happy to be here. I'm very curious for our talk.
Yeah, thanks, Joachim. So that's really an interesting setup because the core from IFM is more on the OT side, whereas Software AG is clearly from a historic viewpoint on the IT side. And I mean, also I'm coming from the IT side and worked 30 years in the IT industry. And what I've experienced is that IT becomes much more standardized. So we have less operating systems than 30 years ago, and even deploying complex distributed applications becomes now much easier with a standard like Kubernetes. My impression is that the OT industry is still pretty different. So what is your experience with that in the OT industry, and what are the consequences for Synedge?
Yeah, you're quite right about being or seeing a fragmented landscape here. And unfortunately, this is true for both the hardware and the software as well. So starting with the hardware, our sensors, for example, to name an example of the more smaller platforms, are built usually around a microcontroller. On the one hand, so you see that's quite small. On the other hand, our mobile PLCs, for example, are more in the performance class of a Raspberry 4. So you see, that's quite a range we cover here in hardware. If I also include our appliances in the picture, then you'll see here the classical IT hardware as well. So When it comes to talking about software, at least in my area here, then we are really seeing the entire range of being very, very small, but also ranging up to quite hardware size, which also the IT world deem big enough. So switching to the software side, this also means that starting with the big side, we have, of course, some kind of standard Linux included, or even customized embedded Linuxes, ranging over real-time operating systems. Yes, there are multiple of them. Down to systems, the microcontroller systems, where in a few cases, even no operating system runs. So this is the point where we are usually stuck with the programmed while true loop, center loop. So you see, the software which we are talking about, and especially when it comes to connectivity, because you know our connectivity is relevant both for our big system, of course, for our medium systems, also quite obvious, but also down into our more embedded systems. Every system wants to make connectivity here. And so we are stuck with the question again and again, how to do this? Are we really going to invent the wheel every time? So this is the point which brought us to the thought of creating one open source project, which of course will require a certain amount of know-how to implement it a way that we keep a small footprint. Because you know, I think a small footprint is obviously in our world a little other, has a little other meaning than it is in the IT world, right, Stefan?
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah. Because that really explains how this range that you indicated impacts the software. Small footprint for synedge.io means 10 megabyte footprint, which is pretty different from some other edge projects where the footprint is 1 gigabyte or even more. So that's really important to understand when to use Synedge and what are other options there. Now, that's an interesting discussion about the differences from IT to OT. Can you give some other examples where OT is different from IT?
Okay, so yeah, sure. Let me put it this way, where OT today is different from IT. Because, you know, when it comes to the difference between OT and IT, at least from my understanding, the OT world is at the very first steps of a journey, which the IT has gone a little far. So let me give you an idea. I I don't know, 3 years ago, something like that, I had a very interesting discussion with a colleague of mine, coming from a perspective of monitoring, device monitoring. So, you know, for especially an IT guy, it should be quite obvious that you are really interested in knowing how your servers are currently, how healthy they are. So this was also quite obvious, at least for me. And then I was talking to the named colleague, and I asked him, why on earth are the manufacturers not being accustomed to a system such as Nagios, for example, so the classical IT monitoring system? And then he smiled at me and said, okay, yeah, guess what we are doing here, what we are trying to do. So you see, the problem is here, the IT world is much more quicker in their innovation cycles. For example, talking about a server, about a hardware machine, so how long does a server live effectively? I think 5 years is really long in the classical IT world. The equipment we are talking about in the industry are being used for 30 years, 40 years, so this is not that uncommon there. So now talking about monitoring such systems really means retrofitting these systems, equipping it with new sensors, of course, without interrupting the manufacturing process, as this costs a huge amount of money. So this is the real challenge we are facing. Re-equip old hardware to enable it for new use cases for a more effective use. Let me give you an example on this. I think you have heard about the AutoZen IoKey, for example. So this AutoZen IoKey is built around the proposition to provide a very small, very valuable addition to such a machine. So it can deliver values, sensor values of two attached sensors to a cloud to enable, for example, the monitoring, a cheap monitoring of, for example, you talked about a pump station or pumps earlier. So let's take the pump station in the Australian outback, where it really comes to thousands of kilometers just to monitor a temperature or whatever. So the AutoZen IoKey is a very simple solution to this. And also these pumps tend to get very old. So this is the point. And you see, this is also here, you can see these journeys. So in earlier days, someone's gonna travel to this pump station, for example, to look at it, to see the health of the pump. Nowadays, we want to retrofit the pump to be able to be remotely monitored. And I don't know, the next generation might have all these sensors, all this connectivity, here we are again, already built into. But again, Stefan, when talking about monitoring, I guess you're quite used to this, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, we have experience from the telco world and other areas, and this experience then influenced the ThinEdge.io design. So, and together with you, IFM, and other partners, we also detected that there's a certain lag between what the IT industry is doing since quite many years and what is currently state of the art in the OT industry. And as a result of that, we added a lot of device management features, including monitoring, and including also over-the-air updates, remote access to the device into ThinEdge.io, so that really every OT equipment, pumps or whatever, when they are already shipped, that they can use monitoring and other device management features out of the box. I think that will really bring the industry forward in terms of having more reliable and easier to service devices. So, but again, staying a little bit in this OT-IT area, I think one other interesting difference is a little bit how IT and OT work regarding standards. I mean, there are some standards also in the IT industry, for example, REST, that are not really formally defined, but that are very widespread. So REST is more or less a standard language in the internet. So how does it work in the OT industry, and what's IFM experience with standards in the OT industry?
When it comes to standards, the first thing which crosses my mind is, of course, being very near to the hardware level, is the good old analogous 4 to 20 milliampere standard, if you can really put it as a standard. But again, this is something which is quite widespread indeed, because it's very, very, how do you call this? It's very real time. Let me put it this way. So you have the connection to the PLC, for example, and you really want to have the guarantee that it's being whatever being switched in really up to the point. And in some applications, it's still common to use this analog way of transmitting data. So coming a bit more into the direction of the border, on the upper level, of course, you have the common use technologies such as OPC UA or MQTT also, where I would like also to make a difference here. MQTT being merely a transport protocol, where OPC UA already includes some kind of semantics. And you know, when it comes to the industrial world, it's really important also to think about this semantics. So this leaves me with the space in there. Of course, in the industry also you have digital protocols such as IO-Link. So an IO-Link is one of the technologies which are very, connected to IFM also. IFM started in 2003, 2004 about with IO-Link, with the consortium, and started also to implement this in their sensors, being one of the first manufacturers indeed having integrated IO-Link into the sensors. And also here, so this is one of the ideas we liked with the ThinEdge IO, keeping it open source, creating an adoption with the community also, as IO-Link is also not a closed standard. So we are also used to open source, if you want to put it this way. And we are strongly believing in this kind of collaborational approach indeed. So for IO-Link also, just to give you an idea on this, IO-Link is a mixture of a digital transmission protocol, by the way, also with a compatibility mode, enabling also the analog access to the sensor values. So normally you could also, at least for IFM sensors, use as well the analog mode as well as the IO-Link mode indeed. And also adds semantics to this digital transmission. That means that for every sensor family, you get a so-called IODD. This IODD you can think of as an XML description, which provides a description of the sensor, of the settings, and also of the values he transmits. So you could, I think you could think of an IODD as some kind of very early digital twin. So you had the, maybe it's not that right to say that the industry is quite behind the journey, but in some areas we are already ahead of it, you could say this.
Yeah, I think IO-Link is really a great example of an industry-wide plug-and-play standard that really achieves compatibility between different vendors. And I fully agree to you that this is even sometimes missing in the IT industry in many areas.
Yeah, speaking of plug and play again, so this is one point we also wanted also for the ThinEdge project, for example. We see in the IIoT world a rising complexity. So IIoT is all about communication in many cases. And communication, as we really know from the IT world also, is usually the source of complexity, of real big complexity. So this is also a point that ThinEdge also should create the frame for plug and play, to be able to connect to other devices to plug and play, regardless of a resource limit, regardless of memory limits, regardless of the programming language being used. So, which brings me again into my deep, deep OT world. Stefan, having talked about, so Raspberry Pi or microcontrollers, have you heard about the language C?
Yeah, oh my God, yeah. So unfortunately, I heard about that in the 90s, so where I did some C projects. It was really a bad experience. So I can recall one week where I spent 2 or 3 days finding a bug where a reference to a stack allocated variable was returned to another function. And that took quite some time to find that. So, I mean, I really try to even not to do any C project anymore. And actually, there was a risk when we started ThinEdge.io that I would have to do a C project, because exactly as you said, it's all about the resource limitation. And you cannot implement efficient agents really in Java or programming languages like that. You are smiling. That's why we decided to go for a new language, which is Rust. This is pretty new, maybe also for the audience, but also new for a lot of developers. But I think it's really worth the investment from the whole industry into Rust. Yeah? Because Rust is really a language that ensures that your software is secure. Yeah? And I mean, which subject is as important as security also for embedded developers? And I mean, just to bring one example, Rust is more secure in the multi-threading area than, for example, Java. Yeah, so in Java, you can develop buggy multi-threading software if you don't use monitors or semaphores correctly. In Rust, Rust compiler prevents you to do that. Yeah, so I think it's really an advantage for the industry in terms of security that we use Rust. So my claim is we would see a drastic reduction in security bugs if more people would use Rust. It's pretty new technology. So what was your reaction, Joachim, when we suggested their Rust?
Okay, so in the first time I heard this, I thought, okay, so what is Rust? To be completely honest, I did not hear about Rust before. So then IFM has a wide range of languages being used today in our embedded development, as well also in our application software development. To give you an idea, so a few colleagues are also using F#, for example. So it's not that we are really stuck with only one perspective on this. So what I liked about Rust is it provides a really, really great performance It also provides the reliability and also productivity benefits. Reliability, now you know, being also a programmer in the past, okay, it took me quite a time to understand that compiler bugs are good bugs, but okay, not the bugs in the compiler, but the bugs the compiler is able to find. You know, it's quite obvious you don't have them as a problem in the product anymore. And even on the embedded side, talking about, for example, the mobile PLCs, you really have a huge interest in not having bugs in multi-threading or segmentation faults and so on. And this is something which Rust solves for us. And this is something I really, really like. But Stefan, now I have a very, very nice language and a framework with ThinEdge, of course. But to be honest, and I think this is, was also a question we discussed earlier, but I, you see, our 183,000 customers don't want to be locked in into a particular cloud or with a particular provider. How do we achieve this with our ThinEdge IO?
Yeah, great point, Joachim. And I mean, with this huge number of customers, 180,000, I mean, it's impossible that you can convince them to jump on one IoT platform. And I mean, consequently, we decided so-called multi-cloud connectivity into ThinEdge. So what does it mean? It means that, first of all, technically, the ThinEdge product, it can connect to different vendors like Cumulocity IoT, Azure IoT, and of course, we welcome also other vendors to add more connectivity. But then we also take, as a second step, a more semantic approach to that. You mentioned the need for semantic standardization. So we have so-called mappers that transform from an edge internal format into the cloud specific format of the specific vendor. So, and that makes it then really possible, even at runtime at the factory shop floor, to switch between one vendor and the other vendor. So, that's, I think, provides a lot of value. You know? But I still want to pick on the security subject, because the security inside the programming language is just one part of the overall security question. I think we need more security than in the programming language. So can you give some details about ThinEdge and the security approach and how to improve security with ThinEdge?
Yeah, sure. But as you mentioned, I would like to extend your statement that we not only need security in the by the language or being provided by the language, we also need security in the overall structure. So being in the network, but also being in the organization. So historically, one of the most widespread answers to the question to our customers in the industry, how do you do security, was, oh, I'm highly secure. I have a network which is firewalled, which is fenced, and nothing can cross my border. And again, you know, what's inside this fence, that's secure.
I think that's not considered secure by IT guys anymore. I mean, IT guys talk about zero trust security.
Yes, this is exactly right. So this is typically one of my answers in this discussion. To be honest, yes, some customers already are aware of this. Fortunately, this amount is really rising. I would also like to say it's skyrocketing, actually. You know, Edward Snowden did some really good on this mindset. But still, we have also a huge number of customers who disagree. So, and a customer who disagrees on this is not willing to pay for security.
I think that rapidly changes after the first attack on the network.
Yeah, it's this is Of course, this is exactly right. So, also we are, as I said, we are aware of this as the manufacturer of products on this. And this brings me back again to ThinEdge.io, as it ThinEdge.io should also provide the possibility for our customers to integrate components which are equipped with ThinEdge.io and also with the with certain security measures, for example, as internet certificates. So what does this mean in particular? I want to be able to securely onboard my device into whatever cloud. This is coming a real huge topic. And unfortunately, this is also quite technically quite complex to achieve, especially once I add this fragmented landscape back into the view, right? So additionally, then you're also talking about authentication, about encryption, but again, fragmented landscape of hardware. Of course, the capabilities per device may vary from device to device. The problem is what, which is coming back to the IT-OT comparison, in the IT world, not that big issue, an encryption or certificates creation, private key generation, that's nothing really complex or not a problem for normal IT hardware anymore, at least not today. But in the OT world, this is quite an issue. Talking about a microcontroller, maybe not the smallest one, but even the biggest one will run into serious difficulties when it comes to encryption algorithms. So the good answer is that we will see in the near future many products with a really improved security footprint, thanks to ThinEdge.io also.
That sounds great. Time is running out, Joachim. So as the last question here to you, I mean, what would be the single reason why viewers should join ThinEdge.io?
The one reason or the major reason for me is that we need some kind of standardization, and not standardization in a formal way, but standardization in terms of a widespread use of the same software, of the same mechanisms in security, in connectivity across many hardware devices, hardware platforms, and software platforms. And I think ThinEdge.io is a really great chance to achieve this. So come aboard, join us. I would really love to see you all there. Okay, so Stefan, but after these words, I would be also very interesting to know your answer to the same question.
Yeah, thanks, Joachim. Yeah. So ThinEdge.io for me is an open source software that provides generic functionality for a common problem. So it provides multi-vendor cloud connectivity with for small devices or bigger devices, which comes with a lot of functionality in the device management area. So smart equipment vendors then can really concentrate the development effort not on this basic connectivity functionality, but can concentrate it on more value-added tasks. Okay, now coming to an end. So if you are interested in joining this initiative, please feel free to contact Joachim or me directly or via LinkedIn. And you can find more information about ThinEdge.io on our website, thin-edge.io. And there you find already the first release of the software, or you can find more documentation, how to use it, or about the architecture. So thanks for listening. Thanks very much for your interest, and stay safe.